All right, it is 3:01, so we're going to get started. Welcome everyone, as you come in. We are very happy today to be presenting a seminar in the Advancements in Agricultural Research seminar series. We've been doing this here in the College of Ag Bio for a couple of years now, and the way that it works is we choose a topic that is of timely relevance, and then we have a series of speakers across 4 to 7 weeks on that topic. We're branching out a bit now, given that the topic for this current run is digital agriculture. We are having both researchers from within the College of Ag Bio and outside the College of Ag Bio to come together to talk about their research and who knows, maybe get some collaborations that come from this, or just bringing together researchers at the larger institution as a whole. So today we have Dr. Steve Shirtliffe with us. He's a professor in the Department of Plant Sciences with the College of Ag Bio, and today he's going to be talking to us a bit about his research in digital ag. Maybe talking about what it is from his perspective. There are many different descriptions and definitions of digital ag and how it's relevant in his research, and talking a bit about what he's been doing in the field. So if anybody has questions throughout, feel free to just pop them in the chat, and then we will have an opportunity at the end for Q&A. So without further ado, I'm going to hand this over to Dr. Shirtliffe. Thank you.
Hey, thank you very much, Danielle. And thank you for all of you out there in internet land for tuning in. I'm getting a very deja vu of those glorious days back during COVID here. But it is great for getting a bunch of people out that probably would not be able to travel. So thank you very much for taking time out of your day for doing this. I'm going to present to you a kind of a little bit of a journey that I went on in the past, I think about 8 or 9 years, I think it's been now, when I started to get into crop imaging as a research area. It really all started when I bought a drone way back in the day. And then I got involved in a grant in the into what was be what became the PERC, the Plant Phenotyping and Imagery Research Center, and that really launched it. A lot of you may be wondering, I know I saw a couple of retired names out there, if you haven't been in touch with me lately, what the heck has Shirtliffe been up to, and how is he actually doing this? Well, I am doing this with some good help from some research associates that are currently in my lab and that have been in my lab in the past. Right now, we have Juan Ha and Fabina Nicetia, who are in the lab, but in the past, who are experts at machine learning and remote sensing. But in the past, we've had people like Hemadudu, Keshav Singh, both of who have full-time jobs with Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada now, and Angika Edetekayaki, who's leading phenotyping for one of the major breeding programs. In canola breeding programs. Anyways, let's move on to this. And there will be other people that have input into this talk, and I'll acknowledge them when their part comes. Let's try that again. Okay, so here we go, crop imaging. Here is an image of some field plots out at Kern, and these are mostly the wheat breeding plots. We're going to be doing a lot more work on these because Adam Carter and myself just found out that we've received some funding from the Agricultural Development Fund and SAS Wheat and others to do some deep dive into crop phenotyping. But here you see kind of the difficulty that world that a plant breeders have. They have a really hard job. They have to, in these advanced breeding trials, they have to go out there and to rate individual trials for traits that they're interested in, which we could call phenotypes. You see a person with a clipboard out there looking around, looking at different plots, trying to understand what are the best plots and the ones to select out there. That's a huge problem, and one that's very difficult to work at. We also, from the agronomic side, we have this issue of yield variability in Saskatchewan. This is The wheat yield by RM from 1958
to actually 2020. There's a little typo that you can see.
This GIF stopped running. Oh, there it started running again. And you can see that over time, the yield varies between years and between rural municipalities in this case. And this variability also continues on at a tighter time scale. We also see now here that as you get later, that our yields have been increasing a lot. Yes, that happened over time because of agronomy and crop breeding mostly, and maybe because of increases in CO2 level as well. Crop imagery can be used to help with both of these issues. You know, remotely sensed imagery using either UAVs, drones, and satellites for the larger problems. And this talk will really be a review of how we're using this crop imagery. At the beginning, I showed you a little, there's a little icon there of the agronomic crop imaging. That's what we call our lab now because we're doing crop imaging. That's a focus of everything that we do right now. We think that crop imagery is more than just pretty pictures, and we can actually use it to quantify different aspects and to help both breeding and genetics and agronomy. As we go. And as we start here, we're going to talk about plant phenotyping first, because that was the first thing I started doing. I got involved with the PERC, as I said, that was funded to the university and administered through the Global Institute for Food Security. And the idea of this grant was to accelerate plant breeding with two ways of doing it, by trying to associate having genomic association to associate phenotypes, traits the plants have with elements of the plant's DNA for things, or to use it more as a tool for direct selection in plant breeding programs, to be able to discover previously unmeasurable phenotypes, and to use it as proxies for yield in early generations. And in fact, that's one of the things that we're going to be looking at with Adam Carter and some funding we got. We're going to be trying to use data from very early generations to try to get some proxies for yield, so we can start to select earlier on that. How did we do this? Well, we bought some industrial size UAVs, and we equipped them with a high resolution RGB camera, which is this one here, which, truth be told, we've used it somewhat, we haven't used much, but the real workhorse of what we've done has been with one of these MicaSense five-band multispectral cameras. And these are called multispectral cameras or multispectral sensors, if I was being a more proper scientist, and the fact that essentially there's five separate sensors here, five separate cameras. These are just small little cameras, and each of these are a black and white camera with a filter in front of them to let just a specific wavelength through. In this case, you can see blue, green, red, red edge, and near infrared light is making it through these ones. These studies, what we did is, well, we ended up with the PhenoVan. Many of you may have seen it. It's now wrapped in some fancy graphics and everything. You may have seen this prowling the fields around Saskatoon and our UAV crews out there with that. At the edges of the trials, we set up ground control points so we can geolocate exactly where they are. So when we come back with later images, that we can use these as essentially georeference pins to line up the images over time. Then we capture the images. I won't show you a picture of a UAV flying at this point, but you can see here, as you can kind of infer the flight plan of the UAV, and they fly back and forth. And the key thing is that the UAV has both front overlap as it moves along, it's taking pictures, and the pictures overlap, and it also has side overlap, that the sides of the images overlap. So any individual point within that area that was imaged will actually be in several different images, usually between six and maybe nine images will have that point will be in. And that's key, because after we upload the file, an orthomosaic is generated by locating key points, and then essentially a computer moves around the photographs to align them using the GPS information, but fine-tunes them using the imagery and builds a big orthomosaic that is a mosaic of all the individual images in there, but it's been kind of smoothed and processed to a certain degree. After that, we have to segment the plots, and we've done a lot of work on plots, and so have some of my colleagues in computer science, like Mark Aramian and others. And I won't get into that today, but that is a key thing, being able to segment off the plot so we can then take imagery out of that and process it and extract that imagery. Because really, what we really want is data. We don't, you know, pretty pictures don't tell us anything per se. We can, well, they help us with analyzing the data, but they don't tell, they don't, you can't run stats on imagery itself. You have to process data from it. So that's what we did. One of the first little projects we did, and we looked at herbicide tolerance with UAV imagery. And this was just in a faba bean trial. And here we can see one block of it there with a plant with seedlings growing up. We've highlighted them with using a vegetative index, what I'll talk about there. And here's untreated versus the herbicide. And all we did in this one is just segment out individual rows because we had some weed problems, and then looked at some vegetative indices in that. And what is a vegetative indice? Well, I hope I don't, I'm putting on my professor part of my hat here, because I can't lose this opportunity to have a teachable point in this class, but in this lecture, I should say, not this class. But light is nothing but electromagnetic radiation. Those of you that attended Scott's talk last week, I think he talked about this, but you see it varies in the wavelength. What we view as light is just a narrow, visible light is a narrow part of that. We can see here, you know, going our classic rainbow spectra there, going from purplish blue at one end to green in the middle to red at the other end, depending upon the wavelength of the light that we're viewing, from 380 to 750 nanometers. Just beyond that, there's also a lot of light energy in the infrared band. We can't see that over. We don't have sensors in our eyes to see it. We can feel part of it. The far infrared we actually perceive as heat, as radiant heat. If you've ever been outside at a fire and somebody throws a bunch of wood on it, and you can feel that heat hit your face, and you hold your hand up to shade yourself from it. Well, that's, you can shade yourself from it because it's actually electromagnetic radiation. But what we're interested in is something closer to this, is the near infrared. And the reason we're interested in the near infrared is because of the plant, given the structure of green leaf tissue, the mesophyll reflects a lot of near infrared. There's a lot of near infrared that the sun produces, passes through the atmosphere, and then it hits a plant and it reflects a lot of it. That's in contrary to all the visible light that's there, because when plants are growing well, they're actually quite dark. They're a dark green, and that's because the plant, the chlorophyll and other pigments in the leaf are absorbing virtually all of the or a lot of the red, a lot of the blue, but they reflect a little bit of the green. That's why they look green to us. And in fact, if we look over here at this reflectance spectra, this was generated on Scott Noble's equipment. We can see here, this is the typical spectra of a leaf. So we see here, this is the blue region here. These are the wavelength on the bottom, if you can see that with the exact wavelength. As you can see that we have the blue, it's absorbing most of that. Well, it's reflecting a little bit, most of it's being absorbed. It's reflecting a little bit of green, it's absorbing a lot of red, but then it's reflecting a heck of a lot of near infrared. And that's what is a really good thing for essentially telling us if there's a lot of plants growing there, and if there's a lot of photosynthesis happening. Because if there's a lot of plants there, you're going to have a high ratio, you're going to have a lot of near infrared from all of the near infrared being reflected off by the mesophyll of the leaf. But you're also, if there's a lot of chlorophyll in that tissue, it's going to be absorbing a lot of the red and the blue light. In this case, we're just measuring the red. If you just look at near infrared minus red, that gives you a pretty good idea of how thick the vegetation is there, and if that vegetation has a lot of chlorophyll. If you put it over near infrared plus red, it normalizes this ratio, and it makes it so that the maximum value is 1 and the minimum value is -1. And it also teaches it a little, it also gives it a little trick. If the intensity of the light changes, if it's slightly hazy and there's less light, then by having it normalized, the NDVI that you calculate won't be as affected. Or if there's shadows, it doesn't affect it nearly as much as if you're just looking at the straight band. So that's what we're kind of using for that. So this trial, again, just looking at a straight vegetative index. We used something very close to the NDVI. And what we had is my old friend and colleague, he's now retired, Eric Johnson, went out and rated that trial. These are all the different herbicides that are there. And what you can see is that these are his ratings. And this is just a box plot showing the error associated with it. When we did it with the UAV, what we see is we got much tighter data with much lower errors associated with. So an example of phenotyping. And so we, you know, if we look here, we can see that we'd say there's no significant difference here, but here there is a significant difference. So we're getting much tighter data. And we published that one. We've since taken that and are using it with lentils as a model species, looking at differences between some lentil varieties to try to develop methodology to identify partial resistance in lentil. And this was Brianna Zorb, an MSc student of ours, has been looking, actually graduated, was looking at this. And you can see this is the rate of ceflufenacil. And in this one variety, CDC improve, it has greater vigor already because it has greater biomass here. And this is the canopy cover that we measured by essentially thresholding it and measuring how many green pixels there are. And we can see it follows the biomass quite closely and is a good way of actually determining the relative tolerance. And indeed, CDC Improve had slightly better tolerance to ceflufenacil than CDC Impala did, in addition to greater vigor as well in this one. Using all those UAVs that fly around and take multiple pictures of the plot area in order to craft the orthomosaic also have another side benefit. Because they are taking multiple images from different perspectives, what I normally do, if you can see me in the corner, when you look at two objects and you move your point of view, normally I do this live, you get that, you can tell the 3D effect by looking at, by the camera being in different positions or your head. That allows you to construct a 3D point cloud of the actual plot area. So this movie that shows it looks like the UAV is flying around. It did not actually fly around. The UAV just went back and forth, took pictures straight down in a zenith, straight down viewpoint. And so we constructed a 3D model, a digital surface model of this plot land of that. If you're looking at this, you're probably thinking, the first time I saw these, you probably thought the same thing about me. You thought, hey, we can calculate volume from this, right? All you have to do is kind of digitally slice off these plots, and you can tell the good plots from the bad plots. The really good ones in here are actually peas. This is a lentil trial. So you can see that some differ. And because we did this over time, we flew this weekly, we're able to calculate actually physiological growth parameters. We borrowed a method that, you know, that loggers had used for a while. It's now become common practice in UAV. Others realized this potential right away and started using it. But we can see here some work that Carsten Nielsen did as part of his MSc, where we looked at lentils. And over time, we calculated the dry white here on our left graph. We did sequential harvested. We also did the green pixel area, that area from looking down from above. And we also calculated our volume over time. And because these display our classic sigmoidal curves that we know from crop physiology, we could also do some nonlinear regression on these and compare metrics, like how long did it take to reach 50% of its maximum volume or 50% of its maximum weight. What you'll notice here is that the volume and the dry weight biomass are probably the closest. You can see here the area actually comes on quicker. That's because plants cover ground area quickly, sooner, and then they continue growing up. We're actually going to be taking this and using this in peas after this, continue using it in lentil, but I'm going to have some work we're going to be doing with Tom on this. We've also worked with Keshav Singh, who was in our lab, worked on using hyperspectral imagery. We had this Corning hyperspectral camera. And what does hyperspectral mean? Well, hyperspectral means, and maybe I'll zip back to this spectral thing. This is actually a hyperspectral sensor here, in that each of these little bumps is a separate band. So it has many, many, many bands. And you can see that as it goes across there. And with that, what that can give you is more resolution, although you can see that our spectral reflectance does follow a similar pattern. And maybe that is, I'm kind of uh, I'm spoiling. But anyway, so we used a hyperspectral camera. Keshav went through all the bands and did some fancy math on them and then determined that these are the most important bands based on his analysis to calculate a canola pod maturity index. And that, and we did come down to, basically we found out that the red, the near infrared, red edge and blue bands were all we basically needed. And we could find a pretty good prediction based on the canola pod color from a UAV, basically on the canola pod and canopy color, we could estimate the canola seed moisture content. It works pretty good, but it's not, we don't have complete transferability with this one. So as you would expect, we can't see inside the pod. So in years where it dries down a bit quicker, it may change, but it's still a pretty good indication of that. Of course, during this first phase of the PERC, T Zhang was our PhD student, and she had the lovely job of working with canola flowering for her PhD. We picked that as a phenotype because it's easy to see, right? And I had this gut feeling, as anybody who's worked with canola in those years, and you notice that when canola starts flowering and flowers intensely for a long period of the time, that's always the years where canola yields well, and that's always the treatments that canola yielded well. So we wanted to test that hypothesis, and to do that, we partnered with Sally Vale and Isabel Perkin over at Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada, and we used their NAM founder lines and tested that hypothesis. And what he did is we figured out that we could calculate this canola phenology over time. Here we can see that the canola was flowering for about about 3 weeks in total. And you can see the canola flowering here. When we compare this to the yield, we had a reasonable correlation over these genotypes. If you look within genotype, you can get a better correlation. But the key thing you have to realize is that this is flowering. When you're testing a wide range of germplasm, you're getting a wide range of seed weights and a wide range of how many numbers of seeds there are per pod. We couldn't obviously, there was quite a diverse panel in here. Obviously, canola flower, one canola flower is an indication that one pod may get fertilized and it may make a Salik, if I'm going to use the proper botanical term. And so we didn't expect a perfect correlation, but we're happy to show that we could look at this. And we published that. Kaylee Chris did some work with UAVs. We also looked at them for agronomy. One of the things we thought we could use UAVs for, and we're still working on this one actually, is use it to quantify canola emergence. And what Kaylee did, as we took them out to fields and we devised a flight pattern, and we worked with the commercial software where the UAV would go up, fly to a spot, go down, and take a picture about 1 meter square approximately. You know, would go down to the ground, take a picture, and then go fly off to another location and take another, and do this across the field. And the idea was that we could use these to measure the canola emergence, because, you know, canola emergence is really important. We know that if you're a field scout, you're not going to be able to get to all these spots in the field. Yes, we're not covering the field completely, but a crop scout is not going to do counts at all these locations within a field. They're not going to have enough time to do it. So the idea here is maybe a crop scout could go out to the field, get the drone flying, capture a bunch of imagery, and test it. So we're testing that proof of concept. It's a canola council experiment. Funded project here. This is our ground cover from some different fields we had. The ground cover is going to depend a lot upon the time that you do it. So it's not a great indicator. So what we did to overcome this is we relied on a little help from our friends. I worked with my good colleague, I don't know why it says, Ian Stavness, Stavness I here, Ian Stavness, and he paired up a graduate student of his, Eric Andevag, with Kaylee, and they worked together, and they were like Lennon and McCartney. There were these two master students working together, Kaylee in the field doing that and annotating the imagery. And what Eric did on his side, being a computer science student, is he developed a deep learning model that would recognize canola seedlings And he devised a front end for this so that Kaylee could annotate which plants were canola and which weren't. And this model was kind of a self-learning model. The more you annotated, the more it learned and the better it got. You know, at this time that we made this slide, it had about it had accuracy of about 92%. So it was, you know, if you combine the false positives and the false negatives, that's what it was getting. Which I remember Eric coming to me and saying, "Oh, you know, it's not very good yet. You know, it's only 92%." I go, 92%? You know, that's really good. I guarantee you that most people counting by hand aren't even that good. So that. We continue to work on that one, and we're trying to figure out a way that we can work this into something in the future. I know I got to talk to Ian more about it. It would be nice to have this release this so that somebody can use this as a commercial product. We've also done some work. Raquel Peters is a master's student. This one, if there's any soil scientists out there looking, we used UAV imagery to quantify what something that I thought didn't exist. People are always talking about the pop-up effect of phosphate. I thought that was a myth. But we used UAV imagery in a phosphorus experiment of Raquel's. And in every site year, we were able to quantify increasing leaf area, increasing ground cover as our phosphate rate increased. Some of those ones had sufficient phosphate already. So it was kind of an interesting way of quantifying that. I'm now going to take you into a bit wider scale, into the satellite world, because this is the other half of the presentation. And, you know, when we first saw this canola flowering thing and we first started to look at satellite imagery and to figure out how to find it and where you could get it and where you could download it, we realized that that you can see canola flowering from space. It's the first thing you start to look at. You know, you look here, you can see these yellow fields are obviously canola flowering. You can see some spatial variability in some of these fields, you know, where it's flowering later than others, or maybe not as long than others. You can also see some sloughs and such as well in there. So we want to look at to see if this, within the constraints of using one variety in a given year, if we could describe the within field variability in canola yield using satellite imagery and just by how long and how intensely it flowered for. And this is Hansen E. Fernando's MSC project. So this is, we worked with CropTimistic, Corey Wilness on this one. And so he shared some yields, some yield maps from farmers. And this is, we also pulled down Planet imagery. They're a private satellite provider, but they have the advantage of having satellites. They have a satellite constellation. They have the second most satellites of any one company in the world up there after Elon Musk and his Starlink constellation, the SpaceX Earth Observation Satellite. There's, I can't remember how many there's up there now. There's well over 100. But so you get a satellite going over almost any day. So almost every day it's not cloudy, you get an image. And so what Hansen did, she trained up a machine learning model. I'm just going to leave machine learning as a blue box for now, and I'll describe it a little bit more in a second. So she trained it up using the yield maps and then using those vegetative indices, some soil salinity data, as well as topography data that CropPro shared with us, and traded up a machine learning model and then to predict yield, and not just yield of the field, but yield within the field, because we had the yield maps and we had the satellite imagery. So to tie what the satellites are doing to the actual yield map. And when she did this, she ended up with a reasonable correlation. We used a random forest. We got an R squared of about 0.68. And so that seemed pretty reasonable. But there are problems with using this method. As I mentioned before, clouds. Optical satellite has this issue with clouds, as you can see here. This is Sentinel-2 and Landsat 8-9. That are actually the constellations we use a lot now. And as you can see, that you get days with clouds and it can be not there. In this bottom image, which you're seeing this little animation, are radar satellites. And this is what Hansen E. is working on in her PhD. Radar satellites are unique in that they're actually active satellites. So they transmit in the radio frequencies towards the Earth, and they measure they measure the energy that bounces back and how the polarization changes. I don't have time to get into that, but it's just they polarize the bandwidth coming out, and they can measure how the polarization changes and how much energy comes back. And you can get information from that. And what you can see looking at this animation on the bottom is that some fields look a lot different than other fields. And that's because canola fields look a lot different than other fields. What you also notice is that the fields change over time. And this is because radar satellites has been well established that they can do a pretty good job at tracking canola phenology, the change in canola stages over time throughout its life cycle. In fact, here is probably, it's probably not flowering. It's probably showing podding there in the canola, that change of the, but I won't get much more into that. You can see here over time. So what Hansen is working on in her PhD is using both optical and radar imaging, putting them together to understand the phenology of canola. And she's using that by, we bought a whole, like a couple boxes of trail cams, and we go mount trail cams in canola fields and then analyze the footage afterwards and to manually annotate the growth stage, because you do need ground truth data to train these models that we'll be getting into. Now we're going to talk a bit about a project that combines both UAV and satellite imagery. And this is Jap Sandhu, a master's student of mine. And what we're doing in this one is using imagery to essentially map kochia. Here we can see kochia. Everybody who's in Saskatchewan, driven out in the country, knows what a problem kochia has become, especially in this drier phase. And in the more saline areas of the field, here we can see it growing in a lentil field, always very distinctive in a wheat field here, and in a canola field, often associated with salinity. Here down here, we can see this field is probably so saline here that it's too saline even for the kochia to grow. That's why there's nothing growing in this area here. So we're using this UAV as our first step to map kochia incident in the field. And we'll go to this slide here. So we have a nice little video on here showing this. We're using a fixed wing UAV for this one. And it takes up, it's VTOL, vertical takeoff and landing. It takes off straight like you saw there. Then when it gets up to about 80 meters, it turns sideways and it basically turns into an X-wing fighter and flies back and forth the field. The great thing about these is they fly fast. So it's actually a UAV that you can use for field scale imaging, and you can fly a quarter section at centimeter level resolution in under an hour. So it brings field level imaging to UAV. It's still something that you're not going to do your whole farm with probably. And that's where the satellite stuff will come into. So what we did in this one is, so we found fields that we identified fields that had kochia. Jap went out to the fields and manually annotated where the kochia existed within those fields. And then we flew those fields back and forth. And we'll just wait for this UAV to land, because it looks really cool. These ones are interesting. There's actually no way of actually flying these. How you fly them is you just press start on an iPad and it just goes and flies and comes back. You can't actually manually control it. It's completely robotic. They're actually a repurposed military surveillance drone that they sell into the civilian market, although you can't buy them anymore because they sold out of production with Ukraine war. So here we can see in this image here, we can see this red line is drawn where kochia occurs. And what you can see over time is that this is a lentil field. It's starting to dry and desiccate, and the kochia staying on is green. And that's key for identifying it. In this case, the farmer actually went out and cut the kochia out, which kind of messed up our data collection for this field, but it's good for stopping the kochia from spreading. We certainly do recommend that, so we can't complain too much about that. Although there's still some little bits of it here and there, so you can see it. When we look at the pattern over time of just a simple vegetative index like NDVI, if we look just at the kochia patch and the lentils on average, we see that they differentiate, and we can clearly tell them by NDVI. If we look at the kochia, I don't show this graph versus the really wet parts of the field. It's only near the end that we can differentiate. But if we use at the end, if we use a machine learning, just in a simple unsupervised clustering algorithm, I think in this case, was just a k-means clustering algorithm, just to cluster it based on the bands that were there. We're clearly able to identify the kochia patches in this case. So this is going to become our, essentially our ground reference data for where we go on from here. So this is how we're mapping. So Jeff's going out and mapping some fields in Western Canada. And we're going to use these, our UAV imagery. This is our workflow for a machine learning model to use satellite imagery to be able to detect kochia. So we use our UAV imagery and we use that to train up a model using the RadarSat Sentinel-1, Sentinel-2, and Landsat-8, which are both optical satellites, which use just visible information, much like the MicaSense Red Edge. The Sentinel-2 are European satellites. Landsat is a American satellite. The Sentinel-2s are better satellites. They've got 10 meter resolution. The Landsat only has 30. We split those and training and testing, use machine learning models, and then validate. How we validate in these is we leave one field out all the time so that we're not just interpolating within field, so that we're seeing if we have good cross validations into fields that we didn't train with. And before we do this though, we do a lot of pre-processing of data. If we look at, here's our crop phenology for the satellite here. Crop phenology will often follow a harmonic model. If you can see, here's the kochia patches over time. And here you can see that they're hanging on greener longer, like we showed you, easier. So that's going to allow us to, we think it's going to be an important data in there. We also calculated some other vegetative indices like NDVI, which I showed you how we did, but you can rearrange other bands to calculate other ones. In this case, we're using a shortwave infrared band, which is sensitive to moisture in the canopy. This is from satellites only that is important as well. So we're using those in our machine learning model as inputs to train the satellite model. We do this within the Google Earth Engine, not all of it, but some of it within the Google Earth Engine. And what the heck is the Google Earth Engine? Well, it's a cloud-based repository that Google started. What they did is they went around and scraped the entire internet for all of the publicly available remotely sensed data that's ever been collected. And I'm talking about ever been collected. There's images up there from Landsat 1 that when it was launched in 1972. So, and it has virtually all the imagery as well as soils data that's publicly available, weather data, and a host of other data, all in this one repository. You don't have to download all this huge data anymore. You can just move your code to there, and within a few lines of code, in this case, this is just in Java. In this case, we've just asked it to look at Sentinel-2 data, the Copernicus Sentinel-2, to filter between 2016, 2022, only look at the months between June and August to get rid of the cloudy images. And we're just asking it to essentially calculate NDVI. And it doesn't include here, but we're asking it to essentially make a median map of that. And that's what we've done down there. And you can do that and download the resultant layers. And that's our typical workflows. We do that, download the layers, then do the machine learning on a high-performance computers here in Saskatoon, or you can do your machine learning there, as it happened in this instance where we did a random forest model on the Earth Engine. So how did that work out for the kochia? Well, here on this side, we see our ground reference data, and this, we're using our UAV map as our ground reference data. And when we predicted based on using the satellite data and not training with this field, leaving this field out, we can see here our red translucent areas where we're predicting kochia. And you can see we're doing a pretty good job. In this field here, we're doing a pretty good job as well. We have some false negatives. Here it's showing kochia growing along the edge here. It doesn't look like it really was growing along the edge. So it's not perfect, but we're still mapping weeds from space. And this could, in these, the practical value of this could serve as a map for applying soil applied herbicide for kochia control. There's very few herbicides to apply for kochia. If we could do this, then we could get a quick map for a farmer. They could apply it there. Yes, they may be over applying in some areas, but at least they're saving money. They're not having to spend a huge amount of money applying it everywhere, and they can target those kochia patches. We also, in this part of this project, use it for soil salinity prediction. And in this case, we partnered with CropPro again as well. And they surveyed fields with an EM38 to measure the soil electrical conductivity. They also took soil tests to tie the EM values to. And then resulted, we were able to map the salinity in these fields that they surveyed with EM38 and soil samples. And these were essentially slightly saline. They're essentially weakly saline. And this is important because there hasn't been a lot of work done. And people have mapped salinity from space, but they've mapped like stuff that is incredibly saline that nothing will grow in, essentially. This is land that crops will grow in sometimes. We again did another a classic machine learning, or what has become our classic machine learning approach, where we use ground reference data, in this case, the EC data as our ground reference data. And I won't get into the details here, but we use a lot of satellite data, a digital elevation map, as well as some soil maps, which weren't at a high enough resolution to actually give us anything. And then did that same leave one out field cross-validation method, this is the survey field here. This is what the electrical conductivity for the survey looked like. And when we left that field out and trained our model and then predicted that field without using any data from that field, these are the map predictions that we're getting here. And you can see for different examples there, as well as seeing, we used four different machine learning approaches. They all were relatively similar. We found that along the way. Essentially, in machine learning, what really matters is, in most cases, is not so much your choice of model and how good your data is, how well has your data been curated. If you just throw raw data at it, you get terrible results. But if you curate the data, and we're not talking about cheating, but if you use your brain and calculate what you think you know from knowing what we know about the problem, then we like if you use the proper indices and the proper data sources, et cetera, then you can get good results. When we take this from these fields that were predicted, we can now use these to predict on a larger area. And this is the first result of that. It's not perfect. I just saw one 2 days ago that is looking a heck of a lot better now that we can mask off individual fields. But you can see we're taking this area here, which is up here, and using that to predict for a larger area. And if we zoom in on it, we can kind of see that this is the area we predicted for higher salinity. It kind of matches up where we would expect, you know, areas around low spots, etc. You know, like these kind of creeping, you know, some ring type salinity and some kind of creeping salinity around the edges of those. We haven't validated those yet, but you can kind of see that we're getting realistic predictions. This takes me to kind of the last big project that I'll talk about today, and this is an ongoing one. And essentially a new one, because we're doing this in one level and we're doing it on a larger level. This is a project that I'm doing with Paul Galpern from the University of Calgary, Christy Morrissey, and Tristan Scholar of Ag Econ. I don't know if you're on here, Tristan, but if you are, it's a shout out to you. We know that land varies spatially in productivity, and this project is to identify submarginal areas within individual fields. And these are areas that are very low yielding and rarely returning a profit. We're focusing on, these are our focal regions that we're focusing on. We're doing this with this part of the project was with funding of Ducks Unlimited is our major sponsor. And we're building a network of growers here, and you'll see why. If you remember back to our machine learning models, how do we build these models? We always need ground reference data. We can't just look at satellite imagery. It's not like a large language model and say, find this. We need to actually train the model to find it. So we need to train it. So we need to identify areas that we need to build a network of farmers And then we need to develop techniques to identify costs and margins, and we need to map those. Our first step is building the network. We've enlisted two people, Andrea Asselford and Tamara McLaughlin, and they are working, finding farmers who are willing to share combine yield maps with us because we need ground reference data. We're trying to predict areas that yield really low in the field. We need to tie that to a real number. And our best shot at a real number is the yield maps from Combine. So they are finding farmers. And what they're doing is they're sharing their yield maps with us. And here you can see an example of a yield map going from low in blue to high and how it varies across the field. And we're getting multiple years of these yield maps because the temporal stability of these areas is important. Just because an area yielded poorly in 1 year doesn't mean it's going to be yield poor every year. So we're doing that right now. And this is a bit old. We have about 60 farmers representing about 250,000 acres in farms. And about depending between 1 and 15 acres. And we're still looking for more farmers. If you're interested in participating, if you're a farmer, this is a QR code. You can snap this with your phone and that'll take you to a place that will, you can contact you. And if you're willing to share data, we're more than happy. And if you share your data from us, you get something back. This isn't the classic thing. We're not just stealing from you and using it to our own evil means. Well, not evil means, I'm just being facetious there. You actually get something back for sharing yield data with us. What you get back is you get a breakdown of the spatial variability in your yield on your farm, and combined with some data that you share about your cost of production, you get back, and this, we don't share this with other farmers, you just get this back yourself. You get back essentially what your profitability, your histogram looks like. In this case, you can see this farmer had some areas that were areas within wheat, canola, lentils, and wheat that were indeed, they were losing money at. You can see this was obviously probably areas that had no crop growing at all, probably a saline slew, I would guess. But it varies among farmers. Here's a farmer that essentially had almost no marginal land on their field. And here's the average for canola in 2022. We can see that, you know, I think it was about that essentially about 1% of the land, I can't remember the exact number, was marginal from the based on the yield maps. Well, this is fine for this level, but if we're trying to do this off a wide scale, we want to be able to predict what is going to be on other land, because there's never going to be enough farmers to share data with us to be able to predict it well. So what we are doing is we're using the farmers' yield maps to train up a big behemoth model of machine learning model to predict yield across that whole, all those areas that we saw. We're trying to predict yield. And what we're trying to do is predict the yield in order that we can take that data, predict the past yield, and then get a good idea of what is a farmer's expectations for profit in the future from that. That's where Tristan's magic is going to come in there, is figuring out how to prop thing. To do this, there's a few steps that we had to solve. The first one, it maybe seems like an obvious one, is we had to understand the variability within, but we had to understand the variability. But if you just look at the raw variability within on an image, you'll see that there's some big differences within the fields. You can see some differences here, but there's also some big differences between the fields. If purple is low in this one, it doesn't mean that this field is really a bad field. It probably just means it has a different crop in it, because it probably had lower average NDVI, because maybe it was growing lentils, you know, a crop that has a shorter growing season that doesn't have as good a ground coverage as something like maybe wheat, which has a longer growing season. And so we have to be able to separate out individual fields. This isn't as easy as you think. There are quarter section grids, GIS grids, that they publish, but those don't match up with the actual borders of the fields. Because the borders of the fields, you have to take out yards, you have to take out sloughs, you have to take out pieces of bush out of them. So we devised a machine, we developed a deep learning, we utilized a deep learning method that was a recently published one that was out there. We utilized that on, we have some kind of proprietary methods using imagery to be able to get it over multiple years and to be able to draw pretty good field lines. In fact, our accuracy has improved a lot since these metrics here. We had about 0.95 accuracy or accuracy. We've expanded our methodology here, and we've now run these we've now run field borders on, I think, 25 million acres in Western Canada. Now we're doing this at huge scales on the scale of millions of acres. So here's our next step is to look at the productivity, and we're doing that a couple ways. One of the ways I showed you the NDVI harmonic before, and here's just that's just the simplest way. And if we look at kind of a high resolution RGB image, we can see areas that don't have fields growing close to this creek, probably because of some salinity creeping out there. That indeed, when we do look at it using NDVI harmonic, but we have some more advanced methods that explicitly take the crop phenology into increase the accuracy of our predictions. We are also looking at the landscape position. We have some digital elevation models. We've gotten access to. Saskatchewan has the worst coverage of digital elevation models of almost any. Well, it has the worst of any province in Canada or territory, including Northwest, Yukon, and thing. So we got access to a 12 meter DEM from the German Aerospace Corporation, and we've classified that into landforms to understand how landscape derivatives, such as the topographic position and hydrological metrics, will affect our thing. And here you can see here how how that describes the landscape. You know, in this case, you know, black areas are describing areas that are either wetlands or ephemeral wetlands that would flat out sometimes, or in years that they don't flat out, actually have high yield potential. And in this case, we see the red areas would be the ridges. In many areas, these will be kind of the eroded knolls that are up in the field. So this allows us to classify the land into that as well, because we're wanting to know why the land varies as well. We don't just want to know what it is. We're putting all this together in a huge machine learning model. We're using the yield maps to train it. I didn't mention the agriculture and agri-food crop inventory report. I'll mention that after, but we have Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada uses satellites to classify what crop is grown within in which each field. And well, they do it on a pixel level, but we can put the field borders around it. If we put our satellite imagery combined with our field borders and our other information in there, put it in a big machine learning model in a really big computer. We do this processing in Google Earth Engine, download the data, run the machine learning model in high performance computing. And then we can develop, with input from Tristan, develop a profit map, and then eventually get a marginality map. Where's our marginal areas? And this can also give us an idea of the relative yield within that. So we're doing 6 crops: canola, barley, lentil, wheat, oat, and pea. We're doing it right now. And here you can just see some examples of the within field spatial variability that we're able to generate with these. These are much better than yield maps you get off a combine, because we're using the satellite data to essentially improve the yield maps, because combine yield maps are only as accurate as how wide the header is and how often the sensor works. And there's all sorts of other problems with that data that I don't have time to get into now. So these are probably truer yield maps than the combine yield maps. What else are we doing? We're taking this data. We're also producing apps for farmers as well. This is a simple little map. I mentioned that Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada has a map of the field history. If you're interested in want to know what your root rot risk for an area is based on the crop rotation and how wet it was when you grew a crop, you can use this app for free. You can you can follow the directions on there. But essentially what it does is it gives you a heat map of how often lentil or pea have been grown in an area. If you click on one of those individual area fields, you'll get a estimated risk of a phanomyces based upon the rotation. In this case, we can see that lentil was grown essentially every second year, almost with pea and lent. So it's obviously has a higher risk of phanomyces. We clicked on another field. In this case, lentil was only grown twice, although it was grown in 2016, that really wet year. So there's a good chance this is yellow because of the precipitation that occurred that year. We're using a satellite data, a layer of precipitation to get that one. We're also changing how we're doing field trials. I haven't given up on the field. I still have my field crew. We're doing them differently though now. We're starting to look at how we can automatically deploy agronomic field trials, because I want to take agronomy for simple agronomic experiments like fertilizer trials and fungicide experiments off of the research farm and do it on others. And we're looking at that. We're using this Moore system for doing that. You can see here's a nitrogen trial with Kaylee Chris working that. I thought I'd go under time, and here I am going too long. I'm going to end with my vision. My vision, we've just gotten funding from WGRF, big thank you, to embark on a project of great ambition, and I hope not folly. We are going to wall-to-wall map Western Canada at a 10-meter spatial resolution for within-field spatial variability and try to figure out for every field what are the major factors causing it. We're going to create a digital twin. We're doing this on millions of acres already, so we're scaling up what we did there already. We're going to map within-field variability, how stable that is over time. And how can that variability be managed to optimize productivity and sustainability? Because sustainability is a big picture here as well. Our nitrous oxide, where does it come from? It comes from our low parts of the field where there's too much nitrogen. We can manage that using information like this. My big goal is to build a digital economy in Saskatchewan. I think that, Saskatchewan has become a world leader in the area of no-till, in the area of small grains breeding. I think we can become a leader in the area of digital agriculture. We already have. There's already a lot of companies out there that are in this ecosystem that are doing really cool stuff. I'm hoping that this and some other things that can be the catalyst. And one of the things I want to end with is talking about the Precision Ag Certificate that we've developed here at the university. And we're putting students through. That we're teaching them how to do all this stuff, how to work with spatial data. We're going to be teaching them how to code a little bit. They don't know it yet, but they're going to learn how to do a bit of coding as well. And this is so fun. I'm hoping you guys can come along the ride. There's a lot of people that have paid for all this research, starting with the Canada First Research Excellent Fund and going through to all the funders that I've mentioned and haven't mentioned. If I haven't mentioned you, I'm so sorry, but I really do appreciate it. But you should be up here. So anyways, that ends my presentation. I think I have time for a question or two.
Yeah, we probably have time for one or two questions. If anyone wants to unmute themselves and just ask it, or if you want to type it in the chat, that is perfectly fine as well. That was a great presentation, Steve. I'm always really impressed and blown away by the amount of research that's going on in this area and the really cool research that's going on in this area. It definitely seems like something where the technology is advancing extremely quickly. Is there anything that you feel like you're just like on the cusp of being able to do that's really cool that the tech just isn't quite there yet, but probably will be soon?
A lot of what we've been doing in this stuff is a lot of the behind the stuff scene stuff is creating custom workflows to just get this working. The one thing that's really missing is what we really need to do all this is good ground reference data sets. I should mention we are working in collaboration with Preston Sorensen and Angela Bedard-Hahn, our dean, in the soils area as well. And, we've been able to utilize some old data sets for example, soil organic carbon. And I pulled that slide out because I realized I was going to be over time. But, Preston was able to develop a model. He's been able to develop a few models to pretty accurately predict soil carbon using satellite imagery. And they're not perfect maps, but they're better than any other map that's out there right now. So that's, those are really cool things. So, it's a lot of fun to be on this kind of, on this, using these tools. And I can't say enough for, Tuan and Quibina in my lab. I'm just the guy that comes in there with a big question and has been around long enough to be able to cry BS if something doesn't work right in agronomy. If the results are really good, if we're getting an R squared of 0.98, it's like, There's something wrong with that model. Yeah.
Steve, how good is your discrimination between very similar lines from advanced breeding materials of, say, wheat or barley, where there isn't a huge amount, but it would be still nice to be able to do this using this technology as opposed to having to work with it in more cumbersome methods?
Well, we can tell on from onless, and I'm being a bit facetious there, and that's about it, Brian. If that was Brian Harvey, I think asking that question. That the level of resolution you need to do that, you need kind of sub-millimeter resolution to get in and kind of see that, and you do to see those small differences are, you know, to actually, you know, to phenotype that variety before it, you know, for those varietal descriptions, we're just not there yet. It generates way too much data. We still are, you know, we're still, you know, the amount of data one generates is still, you know, it's, you know, we generate, yeah, like terabytes and terabytes and terabytes of data, you know, it becomes a huge thing, and just, and we just don't, can't do that yet. We can't do that yet.
Thanks, Brian. Molly, you had your hand up there.
Hi, Steve. It's great to see you here. Just got the memory I had working with birds and lentil years ago. Now in my startup, working with remote sensing and data science, artificial intelligence, and farming, it was really great to know about all the incredible works you're doing. Just worth wondering regarding that digital twin that you mentioned, have you started working on sustainability and making maps for this big important aspect of farming?
Yeah, we currently have yes, we are. And you know, the marginal land project is really about, is, I should have emphasized that a bit more. I realized I was running late at that point, so I kind of kicked it into overdrive. But the idea of that project is, if we can identify areas of land that are not making the farmer money, and if it's convenient for the farmer, if they're not in the middle of the field, they probably don't want to farm them differently. But if they're in a corner or next to a slough or a creek, this seems to be an obvious place that they could turn that land into perennial production. And, you know, like, you know, we have, you know, Bill Billigatou has developed a really good salt tolerant forage grass, CDC Salt King, I think. Yeah. And, you know, or there's other species out there that can be used. So that, and then you're taking that land that isn't growing anything to start with, and if you're putting nitrogen fertilizer down there, it's probably responsible for a lot of the nitrous oxide emissions. You're taking it out of you're taking that nitrous oxide emissions out of the way, and you're also starting to sequester carbon there. So that has a huge, 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 huge potential. We have another project that we're waiting to receive funding on, and to look at what we want to look at, and we're doing this in collaboration with Rich Farrell and a couple of others, to look at areas in the field that are essentially, that have a greater risk of nitrous oxide emission, and mapping that on this large scale as well. Because the great thing about this stuff is, once we get the data down, we can run through the models and we can map at a very large scale. You know, we're just kind of limited by the computer power. But once we pull down the data, you know, we can keep it and use it for other purposes as well.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thanks for the question, Mala. Okay, Runley, you have the last question.
Okay. Hi, Steve. I have a question. So previously, the research you mentioned, I feel they are mostly focusing on single crop. So I was wondering, did you do anything about like mixed planting? If so, do you think are you using, or you plan to using the similar method, like collecting the ground data and doing the analysis on the mixed planting?
No, we've been conveniently ignoring the mixed crops. But, you know, intercropping, you know, is on a very, you know, if you start to look at, you know, the, you know, what is it, 80 some million acres of cropped land in Western Canada, you know, I think intercropping is in the tens of thousands, maybe, we view that as an inconvenient problem that we would sooner not, because we can't, because we're not going to, it's not big enough to bother with right now. We do recognize that this could be a path forward for sustainability, et cetera. But for us, we're just focusing on, we're doing things at big scales here. So when those crops become, if those crops become a common production system, we'll start looking at them then. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
That said, we do, I would say we do, I know we have done some intercropping trials, and we have used UAV imaging in them to look at things like, do you get quicker ground cover? You know, that questions like that. So more on the UAV side, but on the satellite imaging side, to be honest, it's a like, well, what are you going to identify that crop? If it's an intercrop, what are you going to identify it as? You know, it's the algorithm's going to go, yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you very much. We are just a couple minutes over time. So thank you for everyone, to everyone for sticking with it. Steve, great talk. Thank you very much for taking the time out of your day to be here with us. Before we end, I just want to give a quick plug for next week's talk. We're going to have Dr. Ian Stavness from Computer Science talking to us here. He's also the director for the training program in computational agriculture for USASC. So it's going to be a really interesting talk. Please do tune in. And we are going to be putting this recording as well as Steve's slides up on the website if you want to take another look. And I'm sure Steve would welcome any emails or phone calls with additional questions.
Yeah, positive ones. Yes. Positive ones. Big plug for Ian and the others in the series. You know, these are people we collaborate, you know, Scott and myself and Ian, we've collaborated a lot. You know, Ian, you know, don't be scared off that he's a computer scientist. He knows how to talk. You know, he knows enough about the area. He's not going to get lost and talk to you about, you know, binomial or, you know, about some, he's not going to talk just, it's going to be a good talk. We'll give it that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, please join us. Thank you again, Steve, and everyone, take care and have a great evening.
Thanks very much.
Okay. Bye-bye.